Thank you for tuning in to LA Talk Live, reality radio handcrafted for your listening pleasure. This is LA Talk Live, and we're more than just talk. Stay tuned.
Good day, Ruslan. How are you?
Good day, Frank. I'm good. How are you doing?
And what do we do? You know, are we in our third month here on LA Talk Live?
Pretty much,
Good day to our listening audience, because I'm sure they're here because they want to hear. Who do they want to hear?
The cool classics.
They want to hear us. That's right. We're live again, bringing you some great talk and some great music here on the Cool Classics. Yes. So here we are on LA Talk Live Radio, and we're happy to be here. We thank everybody who's making this possible. And why don't you say a couple words about our sponsor?
Oh, Michael Brown. Yeah, Michael, thank you very much for making this wonderful program of ours happening, right?
Absolutely.
We enjoy it. Our listeners enjoy it. Art enjoy it. Music enjoy it. So we hope to find more friends and more supporters.
Absolutely, absolutely. And we want to thank Richard, our producer, as well, who puts up with our shenanigans and our all of these various recordings that we come up with, who are totally new. And we're going to have a wonderful guest on today, and we'll talk about her in a little while.
Yeah.
But what are we listening to?
This is opera.
Yeah, opera.
This is a conversation about opera today, right?
Yes, very much so. Very much
so. And this is the aria of Figaro from Rossini's Barber of Seville.
Yeah, by Gioacchino Rossini. And you know, it's wonderful. It's kind of, I kind of relate this aria. It's called Largo al Factotum. This aria is talking about a barber in Seville who does everything. He cuts hair, he makes marriage deals, he does real estate deals. Maybe he cleans toilets too. I'm not sure. But he does everything. And you know, we're also, nowadays in the music business, we're all called upon to do a lot. I know this is true of Ruslan and true of me. We do a lot of things. You know, Ruslan's a pilot. He's a producer. He's a virtuosic cellist. He's a webmaster. He does everything, you know. And I do a few things myself, too. I'm into producing, conducting, piano playing, whatever.
But Rossini, our wonderful composer, he wasn't that much, was he? He was primarily a composer. Now, interesting, you know, composed, what, 40 operas?
Oh, my God.
And then retired. At one day, he just said, that's it.
But you know, after 40 arias, he deserved the rest.
I guess.
He was, you know, he was like a supernova that burned out really, really quickly, I guess. But he was making a lot of money.
Exactly. And he was remarkably talented, as talented as Mozart.
That's right.
Apparently could listen for an opera and then sit down
and
write it down from memory.
Most of his operas were written in the space of about less than a month.
Exactly. And the famous story went for, I think he was in Naples, and was kind of cold outside, cold inside. He was composing while lying in bed. Was apparently quite a lazy guy. And the legend says that apparently the piece of paper with the aria that he just composed fell on the floor. He was so lazy to pick it up. So instead of picking it up, he just composed another one right there.
There you go.
Put it into the
But you know, he was also an interesting composer in that he was not opposed to taking music from one opera, sticking it in another.
That's correct.
Or sometimes he would write an overture, hated it, and then it would appear later on in an opera.
But the most his most important achievement with the operatic world is infusion of fiorituras and coloraturas, all these passages that singers would sing into the actual score. Because prior to Rossini, it was largely up to the singer
to make a decision
on
what they wanted.
Yeah.
Although some singers, even now today, do various coloratura things, especially the coloratura sopranos, will put in something in an opera that, you know, that will give them a little personal touch.
Yeah, but at that time, that step of his, that essentially what secured his financial success, right?
Yeah, right.
Because
right.
prior to that, imagine, here's a composer composing an opera, and it gets premiered in La Scala in Milan, for instance, mm-hmm. right? Great mm-hmm. success, amazing, and the theater in Naples, the opera theater in Naples, mm-hmm. wants same opera. And the composer sends the score into Naples, and all of a sudden it's a disaster. Absolutely. Why the disaster? Because the singers in Naples decided to elaborate, and instead of the melodies and all these beautiful coloraturas and fiorituras that were presented in La Scala, they just didn't do the same thing. Therefore,
well, that's
people
true
didn't
too.
Like it.
Yeah, but there are also some interesting factors in his life. Springs up, but when he did the opera La Cenerentola, a story on Cinderella, mm-hmm. He made a kind of a big miscalculation on that one. He got a librettist who took the fairy tale character of the story of Cinderella. He kind of removed it and made it much more earthy and mm-hmm. so forth. It's still a delightful opera. Musically, it's really quite great. And in its premiere, because of the weaknesses of the libretto, it wasn't all that successful. And it has had limited play. Now, The Barber of Seville is quite different. He has kept the story pretty much so of Beaumarchais' original story,
yeah,
the Figaro story, which is very, very important.
And I think the key word here is story. Because prior to Rossini, like 50, 30 years prior to Rossini, opera was what? It was just a room, big room, where the singers would come out on the stage, would sing a bunch of operas, mm-hmm, right? Mm-hmm. A bunch of arias. Mm-hmm. And those arias weren't necessarily connected in terms of the plot or the story. It was essentially just a concert.
Yeah, I think Rossini made that change happen. And
where it became a theatrical mm-hmm. performance sustained scenario.
Right.
With a sustained
now, it's
plot.
Not to say that the opera prior to that was not spectacle. It was big spectacle. The Rossini operas tended to be less spectacle. For example, the operas of Georg Friedrich Handel, mm-hmm. beautiful musical operas, wonderful stories, but drawn from mythology. That didn't happen with Rossini. But what happened with his operas, they were all about spectacle, really. machinery, you know, waves and fairies kind of dancing and fire and all kinds of remarkable stagecraft. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Rossini, less so. And was more dependent upon the integrity and the synergy of the story. And in the case of something like his biggest success, obviously, was The Barber of Seville. That was obviously the biggest success.
It was and is still.
Pardon?
It was and is his success, because The Barber of Seville is one of the most performed operas.
Oh, one more, yes. And in fact, I probably have conducted The Barber of Seville more than any other opera. And it's always a winner, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
But the story is quite political.
No, that's true.
Now, I'm not heading toward politics, folks. Not yet. But it's the story of the change that was taking place in Europe during the 18th century, where the rise of the peasant class, the elimination of the servant class, and where it was a definite mockery of the aristocracy, it actually made the aristocracy look like really foolish and made them look like they were really that their servants were in control of them.
French Revolution happened at about the same period of time.
But this recording you heard of the Largo al Factotum, did we announce that was done by Dmitry
Khvarostovsky.
Really wonderful, bright-looking guy, beautiful singer, Russian, with kind of white hair. See, I got white hair, too. Yeah. But anyway, a great singer. And he talks about all the stuff that he does in Seville for all of his higher people
activities,
who would
help
him, you know?
Yeah.
So,
okay,
where are we with this now?
Okay, now, at the time of Rossini, the opera was still sort of a bunch of arias with what they called recitativos. So the actual scenery, the actual drama, the actual plot was happening during those recitativos. There was half singing, half talking, essentially, without participation in orchestra, being accompanied by a harpsichord, usually, right?
In Rossini, accompanied by the orchestra.
That was already a step
prior to that. It was largely harpsichord.
A few years later, we're talking about 50, 60 years later, Verdi, Puccini came on the stage, and recitativos almost disappeared. Everything became sang. right?
Well, in a way, yes. It was still recitativo, but it didn't seem as talky. I'll put it that way.
Yeah.
It was sung, but all of the things in Rossini. The Rossini was still there. Rossini kind of morphed into Bellini and Donizetti.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And even there, the harpsichord was eliminated, and we had sort of the fabric of the actual spoken thing being accompanied by, sometimes very melodically.
Yeah.
The recitatives in Rossini, Donizetti, and Bellini were almost musical pieces in and of themselves, but they appeared as if they were.
That's correct.
Spoken, yeah.
So why don't we listen for our next excerpt? This is an aria from mm-hmm. the opera called Rusalka and Mermaid. Essentially, right?
Yeah, and this is really different.
Exactly. Yes, it was composed really 100 different. Years after Rossini.
Absolutely.
And not Italian, but a Czech composer,
mm-hmm,
Antonín
mm-hmm.
Dvořák, whose piece, the cello concerto, you've heard right before our broadcast right now.
Very interesting piece. Actually, when I first started conducting, I did the American premiere of this opera in English.
Oh, in English.
In English. No, the American premiere was in 1935.
I almost felt scared, thinking, "Oh my God, how old?" And Frank.
That's right. I'm resurrected. I'm resurrected. That's right. Give me my vitamin B12 shots. Right. No. This was in about 1975, I think it was, and we did it at the San Diego Opera.
Well, I wasn't even born then.
Oh, you poor boy. I wish you had been there. You would have liked the performance. But I knew we'd be here today. Together, I knew. Oh, I knew that. Yes, I did.
Me too.
Me too. But this piece, the whole opera, is very, very interesting, in that this lady Rusalka is a mermaid, and she decides she wants to fall in love with a mortal, and she falls in love. She doesn't know who it's going to be yet, but
I mean, she meets a prince apparently.
Right,
you know,
but she makes a deal that I'll fall in love with Jezzy Baba.
Yeah.
And Jezzy Baba says, "Well, I'll make the deal with you, but you're not going to be able to speak. You can't speak to him."
So she's a mermaid. She has a tail, and the witch converts her into normal kind of human.
That's
being,
right. In this case, the prince is going to get some tail, right? but in the opera, she does eventually come out of the water. She meets this prince. She falls in love, and she loses her tail. She's walking around with her tail.
And he loves her for a while, but then he finds another girl, and she kind of fails the deal with the witch. She comes back, and she dies and becomes a ghost.
Well, they both die.
Kills him. She kisses the prince. Comes to visit the lake at a certain point, and then they are back in love.
This is the way they finally decide they can be together forever.
Kind of a tragic opera.
But this is she speaks of. Just this aria occurs just before she sees the prince. Yeah. It's a wonderful piece.
Now, here's a question. So there are understanding, and correct me if I'm wrong.
Okay.
So there are some major vocal schools in the world, right? There is Italian.
Yeah.
There is German, I think. Mm-hmm. Is there Russian?
There's a Russian school.
Okay. What's the difference? Is there like a difference in the colors of the voice or that how they sing? Can they recognize if that voice...
The first difference is in the repertoire. That's the first difference. And that's obvious.
Russians don't speak Italian.
Well, no, because a lot of the Russian
or Italians don't say grass.
Either way,
Germans don't say anything but German.
Now,
right?
No,
no,
it's not that clear cut, is it? It's not that. No, what's happened? I think again, the biggest difference in the opera is the Italian school. Written by Italians in Italian. Now, that doesn't mean that these operas, though they're in that school, aren't done. For example, sometimes we have had the Czech school of opera, mm-hmm. which is in Czech, is not performed in Czech. Sometimes it's performed
in English.
In English.
Yep.
In many cases, we have situations, actually, Giuseppe Verdi wrote operas that were specified for France, like mm-hmm. Don Carlo, originally written in French, for the French, you know. I think, and if we go to the vocal side of it, we might say that, I guess, one is, I as Italian would hope that everything would be built on the Italian style of singing, which would be very open vowels, no force, this and that. Now, the language that you sing in does change that a little bit.
That's correct. That's what
color,
I was going to do. Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, yeah,
so,
yeah, yeah.
So, now, for example, we introduced this. We had, you know, Dmitry Khodorkovsky singing in Italian, and it was great. His Italian was great.
Yep, yep. And Netrebko was singing Czech.
And she was singing in Czech.
And right now we're going to hear in Italian, singing in Italian, the famous Luciano Pavarotti.
Oh, we're already at Luciano. We've already gone that far.
And
okay, yeah.
And let's listen for that. It's called Bel Canto. I assume this is
Bel
Canto,
you know what?
Right?
Keep this in mind. So for all of you who are listening on our show here, we have chosen these arias because of our next guest, our guest who is coming up.
Exactly.
All of these arias that you're going to be hearing today will be heard next week at the Lauren Zachary competition finals
In Los Angeles.
In Los Angeles,
one of the biggest, largest, most you know, famous vocal competitions, and you guys are all invited.
And we'll talk a little bit about competitions and why they exist, and so forth, and so on. But all these arias will be heard next Sunday at 2:00. At the Wilshire Rebell. That's what's that? The 19th? Is that the 19th?
I will double check. Why don't we listen for it right now,
okay,
and then we'll get you the full information about
Luciano
that.
Luciano Pavarotti. Okay, in this, you're hearing Edgardo sing. He has come back to the castle. He doesn't know Lucia is actually dead, and he's very, very upset, and he's really kind of reflecting on he'd like to be dead. And in the, after he finishes this gorgeous aria, he does find out that Lucia actually has died. So it's a very tragic aria.
Now, for those who have never been in opera, right?
Yeah,
so operas generally, most of the time, performed in their regional languages.
That's right, yes.
In this case, we're talking about Italian. Yeah. But, like in LA Opera House, on the top, above the stage, there is a transcript. There is like a running line.
Yeah, they call
the
them super titles.
The super titles. Yeah,
yeah,
exactly.
Right.
So it's essentially like going to a theater,
exactly.
Which is, but it's not a musical. There was a difference between opera and musical.
Well, the musical writing is much lighter. The subject matter is usually much lighter. Although, of late, subjects have gotten pretty heavy.
Mm-hmm.
The other thing, and they're much more rhythmic. They have lighter voices. Do them in generally, and in a musical. Except, I would say, with certain people like Stephen Sondheim, most of the dialogue is completely spoken.
Mm-hmm.
Stephen Sondheim made a little bit of a crossover where he has a lot of sung dialogue, which is commensurate with and relates to recitativo in Italian opera.
Now, what is the famous Italian bel canto?
Bel canto refers to a style of singing and teaching that occurred in the early 19th century, at the end of the 18th century into the 19th century, in which the voice was not pushed, in which you didn't push beyond your means, and you were very often chosen because of the size of your voice, but not pushed. It was a quality in which means literally beautiful singing. Bel canto means beautiful singing.
Why don't we listen right now for another excerpt sung by Maria Callas?
Okay, she
from
was
Madama Butterfly.
She was
Puccini,
the bel canto
right?
singer that didn't always sing bel canto.
Yeah, true, true, true.
Yeah.
Yeah,
right. Oh, this is, and now this is not bel canto particularly. This is Un bel di vedremo from Madama Butterfly by Puccini, which was later in the century. There she goes. Now keep in mind, this is an Italian lady, Italian-American lady, Greek actually, Greek lady who studied a lot in Italy, singing in Italian and about Madame Butterfly, who is Japanese. So that's the mix you sometimes get in opera.
Japanese prostitute.
Geisha.
What a mix. Greek, Italian-American lady
watch
singing.
It, yeah, watch it, Ruslan. This is pretty wild.
Yeah,
this is pretty wild. Yeah, this is pretty wild. I love it. It's wild. Yeah.
So many people were saying that Maria Callas kind of ruined her voice, that apparently she didn't sing
well.
Right.
She ruined it one
but
day.
I mean, it sounds good to me, you know.
But you see, this is singing directed by an incredibly theatrical personality and an incredibly emotional person. This woman went up and down like the temperature in California, you know. I mean, as far as
temperature in California never goes below zero.
Well,
you know?
I know, but one day, you know, but there's a fluctuation. One day it might be 90, then by nighttime it's like 58, 60 degrees.
Mm-hmm.
And Callas was like this. She was very emotionally connected to her voice. If there was a problem in her life, she would be affected by it. She was also very fat once, and she lost a lot of weight.
I think there are no pictures of her being fat.
Yes, there are pictures of
her. There are, really?
Yeah, there are pictures of her being fat. Yeah, yeah. You can actually see it.
Yeah.
But the... But the artistic intelligence that went along that guided.
But you know the reason why I was saying because we are talking about that was called operatic diva, because she was a diva, right?
She was a diva. I think she was.
It's not just a diva as in the common, but there is a term called operatic diva.
Yeah,
and that was the time of those divas.
Right, where anything they said go, they could yell at the conductor, they could tell the conductor, you know, if the conductor would say, you know, Madame Callas, I remember actually this happened, I forget who was it, Madame Callas, you must keep your eye on me, if you can't. She says,
my, you know, she said, "No, dear maestro, you keep your eye on me." So I mean, you can get away with that, you know.
And why don't we move to Los Angeles now, to Placido Domingo?
Ah, Placido Domingo.
Who
yes.
is the artistic director of LA Opera right now, right?
He is that, and he's a wonderful yeah. star, and he's yeah. going to sing from Rigoletto.
Is this bel canto as well?
Or well, it derives from the bel canto, you know, and it's also...
But he's not Italian.
No, he's Spanish, but his Italian is great, his voice is great, mm-hmm. a great star. This is an interesting piece in that this is the first aria that Rigoletto sings in the opera Rigoletto. Rigoletto
by Verdi.
By Verdi.
Italian.
And Rigoletto is a clown. He's a court jester. And his job is to keep the Duke happy and amused.
He's quite ugly. Rigoletto is quite ugly.
Well, he's got a hunchback. That's very hard for him to run around.
But he has a secret. He has a beautiful daughter.
He has a beautiful daughter. And Placido Domingo finds her eventually and falls in love with her. Or at least lusts after and does get the daughter to fall in love with him.
Horrible place of the
bank. Yeah. So we're going to hear Questo Quella.
Questo Quella per me pari solo quant'altra rincorrerò intorno mi vedo del mio cuore l'impero non c'ero meglio avuta che ad altra beltà la costoro avvenenza e qual loro di che ne fato nei fiora la vita so di questa mi torna gradita forse un'altra domani lo sarà un'altra forse un'altra domani lo sarà la costanza tiranna del cuore detestiamo qual morbo crudele sol chi vuole
so you can actually hear our Placido Domingo, of course, was a wonderful singer, not singing tenor much anymore now, singing baritone and basically running a lot of opera companies and making a stab at conducting as well. But he's a great artist, there's no doubt about it. And you can hear that in this I'm not sure where this recording emanates from, whether it's in the 70s, 80s, but it's a wonderful example, I think, of the bel canto style, where basically it just kind of flows out of him. And this is the time in the opera when we hear the Duke at his youngest. Later on, he becomes much more unattractive to us and much more awful. Rather, you know.
Now, guys, you can hear it all live next in 2 weeks, right? On May 15th.
May 15th, yes.
At 2 p.m.
2 p.m. at the Wilshire E. Bell.
Which is located at 4401 mm-hmm. West 8th Street.
Right, that's right on the corner of Wilshire Boulevard and Lucerne.
Los Angeles.
In Los Angeles, yes. Yeah. And the concert is free. It's with orchestra. We have 10 singers.
Big orchestra, 75 piece, I think.
Actually 40 pieces. You 40 know, it's pieces. A little smaller. Well, the stage is very, very small. Still, yeah, big. Still big. And they will each sing two arias, and all the arias that you're hearing on our show today are included among those arias.
And all of those singers are younger generation singers. This is a competition. When is it? At the end of the performance, the winner will be announced?
Several winners, first, second, and third place, and then various other awards are given. But it's a first, second, and third place.
I think the grand prize is like $12,000.
It's usually well over $10,000, usually $10,000 to $13,000.
Just imagine, guys, you go on the stage, sing two songs, and you get $10,000.
That's right. But you know, it's a free concert. So if you want tickets, you have to go to the Lauren Zachary Foundation website. Or make a phone call.
Or call Wilshire A Bell Theater.
I think you have to. I don't know if. We'll find out from our guest whether the tickets are available at the Wilshire A Bell. But I do know that they're available from the Zachary Foundation directly. And
there are tickets, but they're free.
To have a ticket to
but
get a seat.
But it's free.
That's right. Yeah. Right. And there's only 1,200 seats, so make sure you get them right now.
Yeah.
Okay.
All right. Well, why don't we listen for our last excerpt before the commercial, yes, and then we'll go into the commercial. We'll come back with our guest, who is a wonderful singer and the judge of the Zachary competition, as a matter of fact. So we are listening for Verdi, Rigoletto.
And yeah, Ella mi fu rapita, which is the actually the second aria he sings, and already a lot of stuff has happened. Gilda has been teased. Yeah. He has fallen in love with her. She doesn't know that he's the Duke. A whole bunch of stuff, and he's a little bit on the upset side right now because his courtiers have actually not treated Gilda very well, and he's really kind of angry about that.
So listen for it, guys, and stay tuned. We'll be back after these messages.
To LA Talk Live and the Talk Live Broadcast Network, original reality radio, handcrafted for your listening and viewing pleasure. This is LA Talk Live, and we are more than just talk. Stay tuned.
Designs by Ardena, a photographic art and design service, preserving heritage and building legacies through art. Wondering what to do with those old photos or new photos? Designs by Ardena offers custom design, one-of-a-kind, photographic and restoration art. Weddings, portraits, special events, places of travel are all great selections for customized photographic art. For more information or a custom quote, visit designsbyardena.com or call 323-455-1251. Innovative and creative printing are available on aluminum, acrylic, and canvas. Custom frame and matting are also available upon request. So visit designsbyardena.com or call 323-455-1251. That's 323-455-1251. Preserving heritage and building legacies through art.
What would your life be like if you needed blood transfusions every 2 or 3 weeks just to survive? And if you had to worry about all the iron from that blood making your heart and liver shut down? That's just what life is like for a person with thalassemia. If two people who each carry the trait for thalassemia have a child, there's a 25% chance with each pregnancy that the child will have thalassemia. For more information, visit the Cooley's Anemia Foundation at www.thalassemia.org. That's thalassemia. Or call 212-279-8090.
Hello, we're back on the Cool Classics. And
on the Late Talk Live, Frank and Ruslan.
Yes, and Frank and Ruslan are here. And you're hearing Anna Netrebko sing Quando Me Vo from Puccini's La Boheme, which is his working class opera about Bohemians living in Paris and all the trials and tribulations they have both in money and in pursuing their métier, their art, their philosophy, or whatever they happen to be, and in their love problems. It's a wonderful, wonderful piece. And actually, I think LA Opera is in the process of in production for La Boheme right now. So,
and we are having a guest here.
Ah, yes.
It's a wonderful, beautiful Hello. Michelle Patsakis.
Hi, Michelle.
Hello.
She is a singer. She is a DMA candidate and teaching assistant at USC, Thornton School of Music. She is also artistic director for Zachary Society Viennese Operetta Luncheon. Is that correct?
Correct.
All right. Did I miss anything?
I'm also a judge for the competition. I think you might have mentioned that earlier, and a former winner.
Oh, yes.
And she's a wonderful, I might add, she's a wonderful singer. She's a splendid, splendid voice and a splendid personality. And
so what kind of voice do you have? Is it soprano, coloratura, or caricatura soprano?
You know what? I'm a lyric soprano, and that covers a lot of areas. And mm-hmm. as I've matured over the years, my voice has changed. Uh-huh. But I started out, I was actually listening to some of the recordings that we did with the Zachary Organization with Los Angeles Concert Opera years ago. And I was singing sort of like coloratura at the time. Mm-hmm. Funny story how I met Frank Feta, my
son. Oh boy, oh boy.
So I was, I had done an audition for San Diego Symphony, and they said they were doing Carmen highlights and excerpts. And so I thought, oh, fantastic, I sing Micaela, that's great. They hired me, and they sent me into rehearsal and to meet Maestro Feta and to go to his studio and to start to prepare the work musically. Mm-hmm. And I walked in, and I was supposed to sing Carmen and not Micaela. And Maestro said, oh, you can sing Carmen. I said, I don't think I can. But now I wish I could. I want to. Now I could sing Carmen, and I want to.
Come back to my studio. We'll start working on the Carmen. I'm all ready, Michelle. Just come on in. Come on in. We don't live that far apart.
So you are the judge of this competition.
I'm exactly. one of the judges. I'm one. On a panel.
How many judges are there?
I think there are six of us.
All singers?
No. Musicologist, mm-hmm. Mrs. Zachary, who was a musician but a dancer and, of mm-hmm. course, runs mm-hmm. the foundation. We have Peter Atherton, who is mm-hmm. At Chapman College and the voice faculty there mm-hmm. and a stage director. So it's a mix of singers and...
So how does the judgment is happening on music competitions? Because I understand when we are talking about sports, right? Whomever runs faster gets the prize. With music, how do you see there's a, well, I like this guy more than that, or I like this voice. What if there's someone who looks horrible, but the voice is amazing? You know, it always was a puzzling experience kind of for me watching how you guys, you know, debate and decide. How's that happening?
It's very difficult, especially, I mean, music, I think, is an art form, which is very subjective, right? Mm-hmm. There's
Absolutely.
A lot of subjectivity to it. Mm-hmm. But classical music, especially, there's precision involved also. So you're looking for someone who is delivering the music correctly, right? All the notation, mm-hmm. the language, the feeling of the piece, right? Mm-hmm. Delivering it correctly, as any musician would want to. But then there's this theatrical component. Does their voice and their personality and their look, quote-unquote, match mm-hmm. and make a package which is a believable representation of that character and that aria, that role?
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, have judged a lot. I've judged a lot. Some competitions want you to actually put numerical judgments, and then they try to add up the numbers.
Yeah.
I always avoid that because I feel that I know right away what I want. Do you find, generally speaking, on these panels, and that people are pretty amiable about the way they make their judgments?
In general, yes. You know, it's interesting being on the other side, right? Because mm-hmm. you do so many auditions, you know, in your lifetime as a performing artist. It's pretty obvious many times who the top candidates are. Mm-hmm. Sometimes there's discussion about how to rank them. That's a very difficult thing to do, right? Especially because it's not apples to apples. You have a soprano, a baritone,
Absolutely,
a basso cantate,
yeah.
You know,
so you're
a tenor.
Apples with oranges,
right,
essentially.
And that's very difficult, right? So they may be equally spectacular, yeah. And then how do you rank them from mm-hmm. there? Mm-hmm. So there's not always consensus on that point. But the our competition is fantastic in that all of the 10 finalists are winners. They all receive thousands of dollars in prize monies. They all have the opportunity to do this fabulous performance on the Ebel stage with a full orchestra, with Maestro Feta conducting.
Oh, I forgot that I'm doing I didn't forget. You're very sweet to me.
And so they get this tremendous opportunity and exposure, and so and like I said, they get the prize money even if they don't win one of the top prizes.
What's the age range of them?
Well, interestingly,
and to follow up with this question, how do you think at which point singers should start singing? You remember that was a question that we asked.
We asked Mani last week. Yeah,
that's interesting to hear your opinion about it. That's
well, first of all, the competition has a the women is up to age 33,
and no, it's 35 now, isn't it?
Is it 35 for all
of
them?
Yeah.
Even for the women?
Yeah. Last year, I believe that got changed. I may be wrong, but I believe that it's 21 to 35 for everybody.
Oh, fantastic.
Well, I think.
You may be right, you know, because I haven't looked at the application.
Yes, up till last year, I think it was last year was the first year that that actually happened. And I think that that was probably a good idea, and also takes away any thought of discrimination. You know, I think it's a good idea.
I do. I think that's great. Because it does take a while to develop the voice, right? Yeah. Mm-hmm. And you asked about when.
Yeah.
You know, times have changed. Interestingly, I always wanted to sing and inquired about taking voice lessons from when I was very young, and I was performing. I mean, I sang in a production of The Pirates of Penzance as Mabel when I was 11. But I had no voice training because they said you shouldn't train your voice until you're mature, until after you're 16, 17, 18 years old.
Right, right.
And I actually didn't really start training my voice until I'd auditioned for the USC Thornton School of Music, and I just prepared a song that my choir director had assigned to me, which was actually for baritone, and they said you need to start training your voice now, and but really now people start early. The problem is that you can do more damage with bad training than not training at all. So it's finding the right teachers too is extremely important.
Just apropos what we mentioned, I believe that the age range this year is from age 22 to age 33. Yeah, and actually one of our remarkable singer, we have a tenor named Mario Rojas, who is 22. And beautiful singer, an amazing
world-class voice.
So these people, beautiful. Where they come from? Is it? They're not just from Los Angeles, right?
No, they're from all over the world. It's a national voice competition. There are
so it's national, but they come from all over the world.
Correct. Right. Yeah.
Because then it's international.
Well, not quite. It's national. Well, it's actually it's United States and Canada.
Uh-huh.
Now we have had certain people from other countries. Mm-hmm. We had somebody from Iceland who came to us. We have people from Mexico, but they have to have some kind of a connection to the United States.
Okay.
Just for visa purposes and stuff like
to
that.
To be so students.
Yeah, here. Yeah, right, yeah, right, yeah.
So the auditions are in New York for preliminary and semifinal auditions in New York, and then in Los Angeles, and then from each location, five finalists are selected. Mm-hmm. So people travel from all over the world.
Okay, so what's your feeling about America Got Idol, whatever, Voice, all of those things? It's kind of similar thing, don't you think so?
Well, I'm addicted to those shows.
But Zachary came first.
Yeah,
the Zachary came
true.
First. Long before they even thought of American Idol or The Voice, the Zachary was there.
And actually, Frank, I think you should do a classical, operatic version of that, of a voice competition for television.
It would be great.
I think it'd be spectacular. Absolutely.
It would be so great.
Yeah, but it's really the same kind of thing, except we don't sing a cappella on our initial audition, like American Idol.
No, you have to have an accompanist. No, right. And you know, they go through the same, it's interesting, the singers go through the same thing. It's wonderful being backstage. They're very, good luck. And it's so wonderful to deal with the singers backstage. You see them, and they're all in their street dress, and then the next thing, they come out and va, 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 boom, you know, they've got their wonderful dresses on, and the guys look great, you know.
But essentially, everyone who will be performing in 2 weeks on May 15th, they are already essentially winners, right? Each of them will be getting something, right?
That's
there will be no losers.
Right. They get a purse.
They've
just
gone through all these preliminary stages. There will be no moment like it is on American idol, you know, like, no, go away, you know, nothing like
no,
that.
No, they've
right?
all gotten something.
And what if they have a really bad day, bad performance? What if they forget text? What if do they still get paid for
they
that?
Still get
they
prize
still
money.
Get paid yeah. for that? Yeah.
Yeah. But we've never had that happen, really, where... Oh,
once?
They
did it?
Once?
Really?
Why was I there?
Once. Once. One time, yeah. One time we had a situation which was a person couldn't quite finish what they had to do, but they've now gone on and become a great star, so that it worked very, very well for them.
So failures know,
yeah.
happen, right?
Yeah, failures
even
happen.
Even Caruso yeah, or anyone had failures. Did yeah, you have yeah. failures in your... career?
Well, we've all had.
We've all had them.
You know,
those are
the
most interesting for our listeners, yeah. I guess.
Yeah. You know, I will say about this competition is that the artists that will be presenting, they are already professional mm-hmm. performing mm-hmm. artists. Mm-hmm. You know, mm-hmm. in mm-hmm. many opera houses all over the world, some at the Met already. Mm-hmm. So mm-hmm. it's not just. It's not like we're finding raw potential. Mm-hmm. These artists are fully fleshed out, they are experienced, and they are going to deliver a phenomenal performance. So generally, except for I guess the one, over the 44 years of these auditions,
44 years.
It's a very good record. And okay. you know, these things will always happen in performances. It's not necessarily a big deal. And of course, the vindication is that after you've had something happen that's a little bit traumatic like that, you end up being a big star. It was great. It was
why don't we listen for another recording right now?
Oh, Dmitri's back, huh?
Yep.
Oh, this is great. This is going to be Dmitri Foratovsky, and it's going to be Au Vin Dissipe la Tristesse from the opera Hamlet, which is actually the Shakespearean story of Hamlet. Shakespeare provided rich ground for lots of opera, and this is a wonderful drinking song. So let's get a drink. All right. Magnificent singing, wonderful. But you'll get to hear all of this on our program next week. But I would like to come back to Michelle. Michelle, there's a couple of other things that are associated with the Zachary. Maybe you could fill us in on some of the future events that are connected to the Zachary.
I would love to. First of all, for the competition, we need to give the number if anyone wants to get tickets so they can come. Mm-hmm. Call the Zachary Foundation at 310-276-2731. Again, 310-276-2731. And you can call that number to inquire about any of these events. So we have, of course, the finals competition on the 15th. But then the following week, there is a program featuring our last year's winner, André Courville, bass baritone. And he's going to be doing an incredible recital, free admission for opera associates, but $15 for guests. And you can call the Zachary Foundation for that number, and that will be on the 22nd of May. Mm-hmm. And then we have Thursday, July 7th, Maestro Fetta will be conducting the Marina del Rey Summer Symphony. in an incredible program featuring our winners. It's always an amazing evening, July 7th at Burton Chase Park in Marina Del Rey, free of charge. Right. And yeah. then Sunday, October 16th, the program that I direct, and I will be performing also Sunday, October 16th at the Four Seasons Hotel in Beverly Hills.
Yeah, it's a wonderful
luncheon.
Event. Yeah, it's wonderful. Yeah. Lots of fun. Yeah. And if you really want to get a flavor of what it's like to be in Vienna, this is the place. I mean, the food, we even do this wonderful march around the tables, very Viennese. People even dress up sometimes in Viennese costumes. It's fabulous. And
Wiener Schnitzel.
Yeah, Wiener Schnitzel. And this is something that was devised by Nedra and her late husband, Lauren Zachary. And she is really the most charming. She looks like a beautiful piece of porcelain from Vienna. She's a gorgeous lady and so devoted to the opera. So I'm sure you'll like to be there.
You know, what Dr. Zachary did, which, you know, when he first came from Vienna, of course, he loved this art form and he wanted to support young singers. And at the time, 44 years ago, there wasn't a lot of opportunity in the United States. You had to go to Europe. Mm-hmm. And so he started the competition using judges that were agents mm-hmm. from Germany and Austria.
Oh, wow.
And the agent was the final judge, and the agent selected the winner to represent them,
wow.
to launch them into mm-hmm. a career. Mm-hmm. So he helped many people like Thomas Hampson, mm-hmm. The Rob Agency, Stoll from mm-hmm. Munich. When I was one of the winners, I was Heisler Remy in Dusseldorf, and that's how I got my first European contract at the Belgian Royal National Opera.
Théâtre de la Monnaie.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah.
So, I mean, doing real work to launch careers, and again, for singers that are ready to embark on at that level. Mm-hmm. But he also formed LA Concert Opera. I tried to bring some recordings, but I wasn't able to get them transferred properly fast enough. But by having the Viennese Luncheon, by having these other events, now we have the Maestro Feta, you know, doing these other programs with many of our artists, the Viennese Luncheon, to give them a platform to be able
Absolutely,
to
yeah.
perform.
Yeah. Yeah, it's very, and you know, this brings something up that our audience would like to know. You've probably all watched The Voice, and you've all probably watched American Idol. So if you have any inkling what the competition life is like, the Zachary competition is very much like that. The singers come, they audition, they have the same fears, they have to prepare, they're heard by very knowledgeable people, and hopefully, as a result of that, get hired and go on to great opera houses, great performing venues. Sometimes it's musical theater, because many of our opera singers decide to go into that. We had one, Jacqueline Fontaine, who is now singing in Phantom of the Opera. So it is a springboard, just like American Idol and The Voice was, but in opera. So I think you'll enjoy that, and certainly worth having. Give it a try, and we hope we'll see you there at the Boucherie Belle. Do we have any other recordings that we have to deal
well,
with?
Well, that would be our recording before we go
Left
into the commercial, actually.
Okay,
so we still can talk for a few minutes. And
yeah,
we have, of
yeah.
course, Proust questionnaire. Is
oh,
right
our
here.
Proust questionnaire.
Yeah.
This is we get a little more intimate here. So Uh-oh. I hope Michelle is ready for this one. Are we going to go into our Proust?
We still have a few more minutes.
I,
for
you
that
know what?
Conversation.
Here's what
we can pick your
okay. From now on, I want
our Proust
segment to be introduced by the introduction to Tosca. That was wonderful orchestra. And now we do Proust. Bam, 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 bam. And now we, because we're going to put the soprano on the spot.
Listen, Michelle. So you are of the Greek descent.
I am.
Is
all
that
four
correct?
Of my grandparents were from
wow.
Greece.
What generation are you?
So I'm second generation.
As was Maria Callas, as we had mentioned, was uh-huh. of Greek heritage
yeah.
too.
So right. actually, I had some friends because I'm fair, right? And mm-hmm. they said, there's no way that you're 100% Greek. And I said, I know that I am. I know where every relative, all the villages, they were all very insular. They weren't traveling at the time. There were no airplanes and things for uh-huh. them to be flying. Uh-huh. And so we did ancestry DNA.
Oh, I did
oh,
that
wow.
too.
And you
it's
know what?
Fun.
All my DNA was from Well, Italy and Greece, they have together. They can't differentiate.
Yeah. Right, me too. I'm
Italy and
Greece.
So it was like 66% Italy, Greece. Yeah. And then I had the Caucasus, which is actually where Azerbaijan is, right?
Wow.
And then Middle East, but it was all, they all intersect actually right in the cluster of islands, of the Canis Islands, where my father's parents were from. So I really am just a Mediterranean girl.
Yeah. So how is it possible that the family left for United States?
Well, there were... you know, in the, those world wars were, you know, that whole period of time was very, very difficult. And they came, you know, like all immigrants, they come for a better life, right?
Yeah.
So that was their story. Some of them came on boats. My my one grandmother came through Ellis Island, and her mother was pregnant. My grandmother was 14. And they sent my great-grandmother back. Wow. And they said they saw a spot on her lung. And she ended up giving birth in Buenos Aires and never coming back. And then my grandmother was married on her 18th birthday. My other grandmother came as an infant. You know, interesting stories. We could go on and on. But, I mean, they all came for a better life.
Yeah.
Opportunity.
Well, you found it. Your relatives helped you find a better
life.
Well,
they like, yeah, they ended up in Los Angeles, which has the similar climate.
Yes,
right,
it does. That's why I'm happy I'm here, too. And, you know, it's really funny. My parents were both not born in Italy, but their parents were. So, but they hated Los Angeles. I don't know why. I felt like saying to my father, you could grow your garden all year round in Los Angeles, Papa. You know, they didn't like the traffic, so whatever.
Well, that leads me to the wonderful question from Proust's questioner. What is your favorite journey?
My favorite journey, like trip that I've taken?
Yeah.
That I've ever had?
Yep.
Well, you know, speaking of Greece, took my children for the first time to Greece, to the homeland, right? Mm-hmm. And I had never been to Santorini because we'd always gone to the family villages, right, in islands. And so, of course, it's this sort of iconic, famous place. And we took a catamaran around the island, which is like volcanic.
Yeah,
right?
it's a volcano that blew up. Yeah.
And you stop and you swim in the ocean a few times, but there are some hot springs.
Wow.
And so really if the catamaran trip around Santorini could be a journey, that was my absolute favorite one.
That's people beautiful. Visit Greece. Whomever hasn't been in Greece, time to go.
Here's one that I would not ask you directly, but I can do it because it's Proust.
Oh, no. You can ask me anything, Frank.
What is your most obvious characteristic?
My most obvious? Oh my gosh, I don't know. I mean, everyone always comments on my eyes. So you're saying like physically?
Actually, I was staring at your eyes. That's interesting. Just a little while ago, I was staring at your eyes, which are very beautiful.
So, well, thank you. But that's, someone told me once I was 18 years old, and you know, I always used to fight with my mother about wearing makeup, and I wear makeup, as you can see. And this man complimented me, and he said, "You have beautiful eyes, but I know you know it because you circle them." Because I have the makeup
around
them.
Around so them. I think that's good.
It does highlight
them.
So, yes, that's my most
okay.
obvious.
All right.
Well, here's another question.
That's good.
What is it you most dislike?
Oh, I hate liars.
Yeah.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah. Me too. But I'm lying. No. I actually feel sorry for liars.
All right, Frank, your turn.
Oh, good. I love this. Okay. Oh, yeah. What historical figure do you most identify with?
Oh, my God. Historical. So it could be anybody?
Can be
at
anybody.
Any
time. Anybody. And you're just stream of consciousness.
Well, you know, I don't know if this would be a historical figure, and I don't know if I identify with her, but like Maria Callas, you know, who you were talking about her being emotionally connected to her voice. Mm-hmm. And I feel very sort of aligned with her on that. Not that I've had her life per se, but I relate to her journey to find love and then being heartbroken.
Mm-hmm.
And then sort of how her voice, like you said, kind of had this roller
kind of follows
coaster.
That, yeah,
yes.
Yeah, right.
So
Maria Callas, that's good.
All right, well, we have time for just one more
one
question.
One more, ask
for
it.
Okay,
go for it, Ruslan.
All right, okay, that's my favorite question.
Oh, no.
If you meet with God, what would you tell him?
Forgive me.
It was Michelle Patsakis, ladies and gentlemen.
Michelle, there's nothing to forgive with this beautiful lady. Come on.
Nothing to forgive. Lot to love, nothing to forgive.
Oh, all right, and we are going into...
Ah, talking about Maria Callas. We're back at
there
Maria Callas again.
Callas,
and this with La Traviata, in which, you know...
We probably need to close our program.
We have to close our program. But we do hope that while we hear that, you will hear this aria at the Zachary Foundation
and many
concert.
More. This is just a
many
few
more.
Arias of the
By
long
the way,
program.
Yes, we do 20 arias. So there are a lot of arias. And an aria, as you know, is an operatic song, basically. They take maybe anywhere from 3 to 5 minutes. So please go online, check out the Lauren Zachary Society. Or let's give that phone number for the tickets once again.
Yes, 310-276-2731. And these arias are highlights. I mean, this is, you're going to get the best.
You're going to get the best
the
of opera.
The cream of the crop. Yes. Yeah.
Sung by 10 really outstanding young singers who range in age from 22 to 33.
May 15th at
May
Wilshire
15th at the
Bell
Wilshire
Theater,
Bell,
4401 West 8th Street, Los Angeles, 90005. Right.
And I guess we're going to close our show out again. Once again, we're happy to have Michelle here.
Yeah, thank Frank,
you.
It was fast. I mean, every time we run out of hours, so quick. It's always
start going
kind
to
of
an hour and a half, maybe.
I don't know. Then 2 hours, then 3 hours. we'll just move into the studio.
But we want to thank you for being with us on the Cool Classics here on LATalkRadio.com or AmericaTalkRadio.com. We want to thank our sponsor, Mike, and we want our producer, Richard.
Please write us at Cool
Classics.
TheCoolClassics.com.
All right, give that again, okay. Ruslan.
Our email is cool@thecoolclassics.com. Call the studio next time you see us here. Please come back next Thursday at 1 p.m. to listen for all these arias that you've just heard in its entirety. Come to the performance, and we will be back in 2 weeks.
2 weeks, we'll see you.
On May 19th. And we will have a very interesting guest who is a consul general of Azerbaijan.
How do you like that? That's a first.
It's going to be exotic.
That's great.
It's going to be exotic music.
This is music I don't even... I'm good. Can I put on my Azerbaijani costume?
Absolutely. You must.
All right. I'm going to have to find it. So here we go. We're the Cool Classics. I'm Frank.
And I'm Ruslan.
Please come see us again and listen to us again and keep listening.
Keep listening. Have fun, guys.
Talk Live would like to thank you for choosing the internet's hottest destination for the most eclectic sound and invigorating talk. This is LA Talk Live. We are more than just talk.